these studies as enlightening and edifying as I have. For I've never taught a series on worship before, though I've touched on many of these truths in our past teaching, but not as a composite whole. And our study tonight is a brand new one for DBC as we study together regarding worship on earth and in heaven. And in doing so, we're going to look at several snapshots of church worship gatherings in the early church, followed by two scenes of worship in heaven, and thus the title, Worship on Earth and in Heaven. So let me invite you to take your Bibles and open them with me to the book of Acts, Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. What should a church worship service look like? Is there a blueprint for church services in the New Testament that we must follow? If there is, where is it? If there is not, what elements should be included in a worship service? What about a time of singing? What about a scripture reading? What about a time of giving? What about an expository message? Is there a place for that in a, quote, worship service? What about public prayer, a time of testimony, a missionary report? What about spiritual dancing, as some churches do today? What does the Bible say regarding all of this? Now, keep in mind that we've already noted from our previous studies in this series that the who we are to worship is God alone. God the Father and God the Holy and God the Son through the power of the Holy Spirit. We've learned that the what of worship is to be according to the Word of God. We've learned that the how of worship is to be in spirit, sincerely, fervently, from our hearts, and in truth. That the why of worship is because God is worthy of adoration, praise, and honor because of who he is and what he has done or promised, as well as out of gratitude for the blessings of his grace. And then last time we observed seven spiritual sacrifices that we can offer to God as a believer priest as acts of worship. But we must never forget that the attitude of worship is more important than the actions of worship. But this doesn't negate certain actions that the scriptures describe as happening in a local church worship gathering and practical insights we can learn from all this. So let's begin by making some observations on worship in the early church. And in doing so, keep in mind that most early Christians were Jews who had trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ and were accustomed to temple and synagogue services, though Gentile Christians were added to the church in time. And keep in mind that early Christianity was viewed as a sect of Judaism for many years due to our connection with the Old Testament and such. So what did these synagogue services, these gatherings, consist of? Well, they gathered on the Sabbath. Now, we do not know exactly how synagogues started, but we know they were scattered all around the Middle East due to the Babylonian captivity and people not being able to regularly access the temple in Jerusalem. We know that you needed 10 adults with a presiding elder to have a synagogue service. We know they gathered on Sabbath, which is Friday night sunset till Saturday night sunset. We know that when they got together, they proclaimed the Shema, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and all your mind." We know that they had prayers during that time and that they had praises and songs that were sung to the Lord, and that there was the public reading of the Torah and the prophets, in other words, the Old Testament. We know also there was a sermon that would accompany these synagogue services, and even times of giving would be involved. Now, do you think this influenced the public gatherings of the early church? I think without question. But with at least one significant difference, which we'll observe in a little bit. But what is important to note, and which our study tonight will support, is that there is no place in the New Testament that specifically lays out what a worship service must consist of. Thus, all observations are descriptive, not necessarily prescriptive. In other words, they describe for us what the early church did. They don't mandate for us what we must do every time, though there are some things that are clearly commanded in Scripture that therefore need to be incorporated in a, quote, worship service. And there are various New Testament passages that include certain elements that should be noted for their spiritual encouragement to us and expression of worship to God. So what I want to do tonight is I want to look at several passages. And I'm calling them snapshots because they don't give us the whole picture. They're kind of snapshots that you piece together and you get a more composite whole as a result. And the first one is found there in Acts chapter 2. Right on the after the day of Pentecost, and Peter, having got up and preached, some 3,000 people responding and getting saved as a result of the Spirit of God coming and baptizing believers into the body of Christ. These believers were baptized, and we pick it up in verse 42. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and in breaking of bread and in prayers. Now watch this closely. They continued steadfastly. The Greek verb is an imperfect periphrastic. In other words, they kept on devoting themselves repeatedly to these things. And there are four things specifically mentioned and two other ones that follow. Number one, in the apostles' doctrine or teaching. In other words, they got involved in Bible study. That was a part of their services. Secondly, they were involved in fellowship, which flows out of the first. Number three is in the breaking of bread. That's celebrating the Lord's Supper. And number four, they were involved in prayers. And they kept on devoting themselves to those kind of elements. Again, similar to a Jewish synagogue, with the exception of the breaking of bread, which is instituted by the Lord's Supper on the night in which he was betrayed. And with the breaking of bread, oftentimes was, like when Jesus instituted it, there was a hymn sung and there was prayers made and so forth. Verse 43, then fear, a reverential awe, came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. That's one of the reasons why they were apostles, and the ability to do that marked them off as such. Now all who believed, notice that's how they're described. They were believers. They had believed the gospel. They were together and had all things in common and sold their possessions and good and divided them among all as anyone had need. And well, why was that? Because many of those 3,000 stayed for a while. And they had some physical needs. And so we see this spirit of sacrifice and spirit of sharing and spirit of giving. As they had this common bond in Christ. Verse 46, so continuing daily here with one accord, first of all in the temple. That was the first place they gathered, the temple court area. And breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart. And now we see another element. They're involved in praising God. And having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to the church daily those who are being saved. I would call that evangelism that flowed out of this spiritual worship and the spiritual growth and the fellowship and joy and witness of these believers. And so what do we see is involved again? You've got the apostles' doctrine, fellowship, breaking of bread, prayer. With prayer, there was praise that came along as well. and then evangelism that flowed out of this. By the way, do we have these very elements in our church services? Do we study the apostles' doctrine as we study the Word of God? Yes. Is there fellowship? Yes. Is there breaking of bread? Yes. Are there prayers? Yes. Are there praise? Yes. But notice, first on the list is the apostles' doctrine. It has a priority status. You see, apart from doctrine, what would you fellowship around? Apart from doctrine, you want to understand what you're doing with the breaking of bread. Apart from doctrine, you wouldn't know how to pray according to the will of God, nor could you praise God intelligently apart from doctrine. And so they gathered to exalt the Lord in worship and edify the saints, and then they scattered to evangelize with their focus again on the Lord Jesus Christ. That's our first snapshot. Now go with me to Acts chapter 13. Acts chapter 13. Now, a number of years later, we see another snapshot here. And this is the church at Antioch, a very diverse church in a very strategic location, in which the first missionary journeys would be launched from this church. Verse 1. Now, in the church that was at Antioch, there were certain prophets and teachers. Then let me highlight this. These both would be communicators of the Word of God. Again, we see this heavy emphasis on learning the Scriptures. And five of them are mentioned by name. Barnabas, we know him. Simeon, who was called Niger. Lucius of Cyrene. Manaen, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch. And Saul, we know him to be also the Apostle Paul. As they ministered to the Lord and they fasted. Now let me comment on fasting for a moment. You find fasting in the Old Testament. You find fasting in the New Testament. There's nothing unbiblical about fasting. Unless it's approached in a meritorious way. When they fasted, they said, I'm willing to give up eating for a while because I want to just focus on the Lord. I want to spend time in prayer, and I'm going to bypass a Big Mac in the process. It wasn't something that was commanded, but it was something they did. It wasn't something meritorious in the sense they thought, God's looking down and says, man, I see you gave up that Big Mac. I'm impressed. I guess I'll give you what you want. No, then that wouldn't be grace. But it was a time in which they would devote themselves to spiritual focus. And so having fasted and prayed and laid hands on them, they sent them away. So the church now, and especially the leadership, sends out the first missionary team. So being sent out by the Holy Spirit through the local church, they went down to Seleucia, and from there they sailed to Cyprus. And when they arrived at Salamis, they preached the word of God, and the gospel in particular. Where did they go? In the synagogue of the Jews. Why? Because to the Jew first and also to the Greek. And secondly, the Jews already believed the Old Testament, so therefore there was to be a much easier in than to Gentiles who had no biblical background. And they also had John Mark as their assistant. And so we see here the first missionary journey of Paul. Now go with me to Acts chapter 14. For at the end of this journey, they returned back to their home church, the church at Antioch, verse 26. And there they sailed to Antioch, where they had been commended to the grace of God for the work which they had completed. Now when they had come and gathered, and I want you to note this again, when they had come and gathered the church together, they reported all that God had done with them and that he had opened the door of faith to the Gentiles, so they stayed there a long time with the disciples. Now, what new element was involved in their worship? Well, the new element involved in their worship was indeed a missionary report. That's the new element, a missionary report. Not a weekly activity of the church, but it was done when it was appropriate. And by the way, here at DBC, do we have missionary reports? Yes. Not a weekly element of our services, but when appropriate, either before or after a missions trip. Now go with me to Acts chapter 20. And we see a third snapshot here. And we were just trying to piece together an idea of what this early church was like and what happened when they gathered together. In Acts chapter 20, we begin in verse 7. Now on the first day of the week, when the disciples came together to break bread, Paul, ready to depart the next day, spoke to them and continued his message until midnight. Now, the first thing I want to point out is this phrase, the first day of the week. The first day of the week is not the Sabbath. The Sabbath is the seventh day of the week. The first day of the week is Sunday. And by the way, it is not, quote, the Christian Sabbath. There's no such thing as a Christian Sabbath. Now, why did they gather on the first day of the week? It is because that was the day in which our Lord was resurrected. And if you follow the passage closely, you will see that they actually met in the evening, not in the morning. Now, why was that? Well, maybe because many of them were slaves and they had to work during the day, or that worked out schedule-wise better for people. There's nothing to say, one, you have to do it on Sunday, or two, that you have to do it a certain time on Sunday. There's a flexibility that we see here. But it was when the disciples came together. There was set times, and there was some place in which they met, and they met to break bread, which is, again, in reference to the celebration of the Lord's Supper. Now, that phrase, came together, is the Greek word synago, in which we get the word synagogue. A synagogue was a place where they gathered together. And Paul spoke to them, he preached to them, and he continued his message until midnight. Now, some have projected that was a five-hour message. Now, I don't know how long it was, but I do know later it was long preaching, it says. And furthermore, that's why we tend to call our, quote, sermons here messages. Why? Because right there, he continued his message until midnight. Verse 8, there were many lamps in the upper room where they were gathered together. Notice again. Over and over again, I keep seeing the gather together, gather together, gather together. And then I ask myself, why don't some Christians gather together? Well, I can worship the Lord at home. Well, of course you can. But is it not true if you're worshiping at the Lord at home and you're enjoying the Lord and you're enjoying Jesus Christ, wouldn't you want to do that with other people too? When they gather together. Verse 9, and in a window sat a certain young man named Eutychus. You know, I've always had to laugh at his name. You know what his name means? Fortunate. Who was sinking into a deep sleep. That's never happened here, but I've heard about it. And he was overcome by sleep, and as Paul continued speaking, he fell down from the third story, which means it must have been a pretty large room, and was taken up dead. But Paul went down, fell on him, embracing him, said, do not trouble yourself, for his life is in him. Now, when he had come up, he had broken bread and eaten and talked a long while, even till daybreak. So there was fellowship that followed, because he knew this was the last day he was going to be with him. He departed, and they brought the young man in alive, and they were not a little comforted. In other words, they were comforted a whole bunch. So glad that Paul was there that night, huh? By the way, if you follow the train of thought, if he continued his message till midnight and they broke bread after this incident that occurred, then they really didn't celebrate the Lord's Supper on Sunday, did they? They celebrated on Monday. Now, why do I say that? Because I have known some people who say, you have to do it every week and it has to be on Sunday. Well, apparently, it was on Monday here. So much for those who insist it must be every Sunday. Now, what elements were involved in their worship gathering? Now, think about it. There was a corporate gathering, and they celebrated the Lord's Supper. And again, with the Lord's Supper would be involved singing and praying. And then there was a long sermon. Please note the word long. And there was fellowship. And there was obviously a real focus on the Lord Jesus Christ. And by the way, this is again what we do here at DBC. We gather, we celebrate, we sing, we pray. We have long sermons. This is one of my life verses. And we fellowship. Now let's see another snapshot. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 11. As we think of the Lord's Supper. You're familiar with this passage. But this passage is the longest, most definitive passage in the New Testament epistles regarding the Lord's Supper. And it was corrective in nature by virtue of the abuses that were occurring with the Lord's Supper at the Corinthian church. 1 Corinthians 11, we want to begin in verse 17. Paul writes, "Now in giving these instructions, I do not praise you, since you come together not for the better but for the worse." Now, I want you to notice the phrase, "come together." Again, you're going to see it multiple times in 1 Corinthians. But when they came together, it wasn't for the better but for the worse. You know, that happens sometimes in local churches, or it happens sometimes in people's homes. You know, when carnal believers get together, it's not for the better, it's for the worse. But notice, these believers did come together. They did not know anything of Lone Ranger Christianity when a local church was available. Yet coming together can be for the worse when you're dealing with carnal believers. Verse 18, "For first of all, when you," there's that phrase again, "come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you." You know, there are divisions sometimes due to standing firm on doctrine. But more often than not, over the years here at DBC, when there have been divisions, it's been in non-doctrinal areas. Is someone disgruntled or complaining or bugged or bothered by whatever? And you know, when it comes to a genuine accusation against an elder, there's a place, 1 Timothy 5, for that, on the basis of two or three witnesses. And then they that sin rebuke before all that others may fear. But so often it's just personality issues or preference issues or things that really aren't substantial. And you know, when you're together as a church for 15, 20, 30 years, just like a family, aren't there going to be some differences along the way? Aren't there going to be some decisions made that you would, you know, have seen done a different way? There's decisions that have been made here that if I were to do them again, I'd do it differently. But there weren't doctrinal differences. And it wasn't done out of personal agendas. And as a result, you grow as you go, and we hopefully look to the Lord and we row together for the cause of Jesus Christ. And Paul says in verse 19, "For there must also be factions among you, that those who are approved may be recognized among you." And that word "approved" is real interesting. It carries the idea they pass the test of walking in the Spirit. They're operating out of biblical principle and true love versus those operating out of the flesh or emotions or human viewpoints. And you know, when there's divisions in the church, there's usually a lot of heat but not a lot of light when it comes to church divisions. Now he continues, verse 20. "Therefore, when you come together in one place," there it is again, a third time. Come together in one place. Wherever the church gathers, as the building is not the issue. And you know, my pastor would really hammer on this sometimes. Because so often when people walk by sight, it's all about the building. In fact, I was talking to a pastor today and we were talking about this very issue. I says, "Isn't it funny?" And he's going through a building project, this particular pastor. And I said, "Isn't it funny, when you study the scriptures, the issue isn't where you worship, it's who and what and how and why. And yet, how many times have we been bent out of shape about where and about the building, which really is secondary? You see, our identity is in Christ and our community is the local church. And some people build buildings with hope they're going to attract a crowd, and it's all backwards. Because the people are the church. So when you come together in one place, it's not to eat the Lord's Supper. You say it is, but it's really not. For in eating, each one takes his own supper ahead of others, and one is hungry and another is drunk. What? Do you not have houses to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and shame those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you in this? I do not praise you. In other words, I rebuke you for your selfish carnality. Now, what is this all about? This is about an agape potluck meal that they would have before they celebrated the Lord's Supper. And in doing so, some would bring stuff, and others were too poor to bring something. And the people who brought it, instead of sharing it, were going in their little corner. We've got four, no more, shut the door, have their holy huddle, and eat their stuff. And the rest were left out in the cold. And then we were supposed to picture here the unity of the local church and our common bond in Christ when we celebrate the Lord's Supper. The thing was a joke. It was an absolute facade. And you know, when we're not walking in the Spirit and we're playing church, it's a facade here too. So then he communicates about the Lord's Supper, verse 23. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this, why? In remembrance of me. The Lord's Supper is a time to remember him. In the same manner, also he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. For as often as. In the early church, we saw in Acts 2, they did it every day. We saw in Acts 20, they did it once a week. In 1 Corinthians, it says, as often as you do it. The Bible doesn't mandate how often we must do it, but we are to do it. Some do it every week, some do it every month, some do it six times a year, some even do it less. Each church must decide before the Lord how they want to handle it. But what is important is that we do it. And once again, the Lone Ranger Christian separates himself from doing this so often. How many of them ever do it at home? And furthermore, when they do it at home, it's really bypassing the fact that this was to be done corporately as a body of believers. Thus, in verse 27, he says, therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. In other words, it needs to be done reverently, confronting carnality. It's to be done in spirit and in truth again. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason, many are weak and sick among you by way of divine discipline, and many sleep. God has even taken some home to heaven. For if we would judge ourselves, and we weren't, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened by the Lord that we may not be condemned with the world. Therefore, my brethren, when you, there it is again, the issue is not will you, but when you come together to eat, wait for one another. But if anyone is hungry, let him eat at home, lest you, there you go, come together for judgment, and the rest I will set in order when I come. So again, what do we see from this passage about the elements of worship when the church gathers? Again, we see a corporate gathering of believers. We see in this case a potluck agape supper before the service, and we see the celebration of the Lord's Supper with praises and prayer and personal examination. And again, this has shaped the elements of our service here at Duluth Bible Church. We have corporate gatherings. We do have potlucks, sometimes before the service, like on Wednesday night, sometimes after the service. There are to be times of fellowship, not just getting a meal. And we do celebrate the Lord's Supper, and we do praise Him, and we do pray, and we do examine ourselves in the process. The question is, when you come together, do you come together for the better or for the worse? The issue isn't so much who's going to minister to you, but what are you bringing to the table? And are you focusing on the Lord and you focusing on ministering to others? Or again, is it all about you? A fifth snapshot of early Christian worship is found in 1 Corinthians 14. So let's turn there. 1 Corinthians 14. In fact, there are several snapshots we see in 1 Corinthians 14. And in chapter 14, he is contrasting prophecy versus tongues. And he's saying prophecy is the greater gift. Tongues is the least important gift. It is a sign to unbelieving Jews of coming judgment. It's secondarily a sign to the church that God is blessing them as a church. And unless interpreted, it has no edification value, because how can you be built up if you don't understand what's being said? Because remember, tongues were the ability to speak in a known foreign language apart from the learning process. So we pick it up in verse 5. Paul says, I wish you all spoke with tongues, but even more that you prophesied. Why? For he who prophesies is greater than he who speaks with tongues, unless indeed he interprets, then it could have some value. Now watch this, that the church may receive edification. You see, when we gather together, it's to worship and exalt the Lord, but it's also to build up one another. There's an edificational sense to it. We're here to be edified, not entertained. Verse 6, but now, brethren, if I come to you speaking with tongues, and he could have, what shall I profit you unless I speak to you either by revelation or by knowledge or by prophesying or by teaching? In other words, if I came and spoke in tongues and no one interpreted, there would be no value, where these other things don't need interpretation. And every one of those things that are mentioned, knowledge, prophesying, teaching, revelation, involve the communication of the Word of God. Verse 7, even things without life, for example, whether flute or harp, let's take some musical instruments. When they make a sound, unless they make a distinction in the sound, distinct notes when you play those instruments, how will it be known what is piped or played? It won't. For if the trumpet makes an uncertain sound, who will prepare for battle? No one, because they don't understand the meaning of the notes. So likewise, you, unless you utter by the tongue words easy to understand. Now please note that. Easy to understand. How would be known what is spoken? For you'll be speaking into the air. In other words, you may be speaking, but no one's getting it. You know, one of the things I've taught the Gibbs students is the issue is not did you say it, the issue is did they get it. And unless you give words easy to understand, they're not going to be edified. If you get intoxicated with the exuberance of your verbosity and no one understands what you're saying, obviously, it's of no value. Verse 10. There are, it may be, so many kinds of languages in the world, and none of them is without significance. The word means without meaning. In other words, words in different languages have distinct meanings, or there's no communication. Verse 11, therefore, if I do not know the meaning of the language, I shall be a foreigner to him who speaks, and he who speaks will be a foreigner to me. You know, that's happened several times recently at DBC. We have a couple that's coming to church here who do not speak English, they speak French. And as a result, at the door, we just look at each other and go, you know, no parlez-vous français, you know. And that's all I know. And they don't understand me much. Probably a little more than I understand them. We're strangers. Why? Because we can't communicate? No, we can communicate, but we're not communicating in a way that's easy to be understood, because we don't know the language of each other. And that's his point, verse 12. Even so, since you are zealous for spiritual gifts, let it be for the edification of the church that you seek to excel. And the church will not be edified if they do not understand what you are saying, regardless of how eloquent you might be. So if someone in a gathering of the church spoke in tongues, let's say, in fluent Swahili, and you didn't understand Swahili, how can you be edified? You can't. And that's why there needs to be an interpreter present. Or else the person, as we're going to see, is told to not speak. Verse 13, therefore, let him who speaks in a tongue pray that he may interpret. Verse 14, for if I pray in a tongue, now I just want you to notice these, my spirit prays, but my understanding is unfruitful. Now remember, the context is the gathering of the church again. So what was one of the things that was happening in the church? When they gathered, they would pray. And here the guy says, my spirit prays. You know, I'm praying from my heart. I'm praying sincerely. I'm praying, but my understanding is unfruitful if I don't know what I'm saying. What is the conclusion then? I will pray with the spirit, and I will pray with the understanding. In other words, I will pray in a language I understand and others understand as well. Now notice another element of the church service. I will sing. So praying's going on in this service. Singing's going on. I will sing with the Spirit, and I will also sing with the understanding. Otherwise, if you bless with the Spirit, and the word bless means you give thanks, and you're thanking the Lord, and you're doing it from the heart, the Spirit, the inner person, how will he who occupies the place of the uninformed say, amen, at your giving of thanks, since he does not understand what you say? For you indeed give thanks well. I mean, you're really thanking the Lord, but the other's not edified because he can't understand a word you're saying. Now, I've seen this in El Salvador. And in fact, I think this probably goes on in various churches around the world. Someone up front begins to pray, and everyone in the pew starts praying their own prayer. This is very common. And they'll start, you'll hear this. It just sounds like a rooster. I mean, a chicken coop. That's what it sounds like. And at the end, how could they ever say amen to this person's prayer? Because they're all praying their own prayer at the same time, and they don't even know hardly he stopped. And so you don't have to speak in tongues to violate this principle. But note again, the praying in the public assembly, the singing in the public assembly, the communication of the word of God in the public assembly, the giving of thanks, amens, following prayer. But notice again, singing with understanding, words easily understood. See, that's one of the problems I have at times with contemporary music. Sometimes it's very shallow in its doctrine, very repetitive. Or it's sang in a way that detracts from the lyrics. Or perhaps the rhythm competes with the words and drowns out the lyrics. In fact, I have at times watched audience singing with contemporary singers. And if you ever watch them closely, you will see a lot of times the audience doesn't sing with them. You know why? Because they can't. Because the singers are all over the map, sliding up and down. And the people can't follow. Because it's not sung in an easy-to-sing kind of a way. Verse 18. I thank my God I speak with tongues more than you all, yet in the church, please note that phrase, I would rather speak five words with my understanding, my intellect engaged in knowing what I'm saying, that I may, here again, teach others also, than 10,000 words in a tongue. So again, we see this teaching element with clear, intelligent teaching going on when the church gathers. So what are some of the elements we've just observed in the church gathering? Well, we've seen again corporate gathering for exaltation of Christ and edification of believers. We've seen praying with one spirit in clarity. We've seen singing with one spirit in clarity. Notice, we're not bypassing worshiping in spirit, but also in truth. Clear communication of the word of God in everything. Giving thanks to God and amens following. Now notice a little farther down. By the going back to this, Isn't this what we do at DBC? Now, when someone says, does it really matter if it comes from your heart? And the answer is, yeah, it does matter. Again, we worship in spirit and in truth. And we've just seen here, if it's not communicated clearly and accurately, then how do you worship appropriately? In teaching, in songs, in prayers. On the other hand, you know what? We can teach it accurately. We can pray flawlessly. And God might say it stinks. If it's not really done from the heart as an act of worship to Him. Now let's pick it up in verse 23. Therefore, if the whole church comes together in one place, there's that phrase again, look at it. Comes together in one place. Again, this is normal, expected, desired, usual. And let's just assume for a minute that all speak with tongues. And there come in those who are uninformed or unbelievers. Will they not say that you're out of your mind, you're local, you're crazy, you're nuts? That's exactly what he's saying. Pretty soon they're going to start singing, I got to get out of this place. Sounds like a song I grew up with. Verse 24. But if all prophesy and an unbeliever, an uninformed person comes in, he is convinced by all, he is convicted by all. Why is he convicted? Because he's hearing a message that's speaking to his heart, a message easy to understand, a message that's convicting to him of his sin or his unbelief. And I would take it that in light of the response, you're going to see that contained in that message was the gospel. And perhaps that was part of even when they celebrated the Lord's Supper, he's going to hear the gospel. So what happens, verse 25, and thus the secrets of his heart are revealed, they're exposed. And so falling down on his face in a posture of humility, he will, notice again, worship God. Proskuneo. And again, this is the objective of the service. He's going to worship God. And he's going to witness now. He's going to report that God is truly among you. That there's something different about this church. There's something different. God is truly among you. But how is that going to happen? By the clear communication of the Word of God. By things being done decently in order. By things being done in a way that are edifying. And that's why verse 26 says, how is it then, brethren, whenever, and there you are again, you come together, there we see it again, each of you has a song to sing, has a teaching, some doctrine to communicate, has a tongue, which again is fitting in the early church, when tongues were still in existence, has a revelation as prophecy was still there until the Word of God was complete, and has an interpretation. What's the bottom line? Let all things be done again for edification. God is to be worshipped. Believers are to be edified, not entertained. And we see in verse 26 a variety of activities involved in doing that. Now drop down to verse 40. For after he gives some regulations about tongue speaking in the church and then about prophecy, we pick it up in verse 40. Let all things be done decently and in order. The word decently means properly, and in order means in an orderly manner. It is the opposite of chaos and confusion, like some, quote, worship services are today. Now this isn't order for order's sake. This is order for edification's sake. And you know, some, quote, worship services miserably fail these biblical regulations. Let all things be done decently and in order. So what elements were involved in their worship gathering? Well, again, corporate gathering. We see here, I believe the preaching of the gospel is there. Worshiping God, singing a psalm, biblical teaching, believers edified, things done decently and in order. So again, we get another snapshot of what's going on in these early church worship services. Now, while it's handy, go to 1 Corinthians 16. 1 Corinthians 16, and we'll see another little snapshot, and we'll add another piece to the puzzle here. Verse 1. Now concerning the collection for the saints. This is a church offering. And it's for the saints, probably the poor believers in Jerusalem. As I have given orders to the churches of Galatia, so you must do also. Now notice the word do. This isn't to intend to do. It's not talking about it. You need to carry this out. Verse 2, on the first day of the week. And again, this is when the church would gather, right? When did they gather? First day of the week. Let each one, no exceptions, whether rich or poor, if you were a believer, you were to lay something aside. You were to intentionally plan and lay aside something of what you made that week in order to give it up, to give it in this offering, in this collection. Storing up as he may prosper, based on how God has prospered you. We don't see any percentage given here, any tithe or 10%. As the Lord has prospered, you're to give, that there be no collections when I come. So they were to save it and then come and give it as unto the Lord when the church gathered. It was intentional planning, not emotional manipulation. And it was dependent on how the person did financially. They put some aside and saved it and then gave it proportionally. And again, we learn from this passage the collection of an offering was part of the church service and worship to God. Now go with me to Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3. Now let's expand our understanding a little bit about this area of singing. And by the way, Colossians 3, starting in verse 12, talks about all these corporate things in our relationships with one another. Bearing with one another, verse 13. Forgiving one another, verse 13. Having love for one another, verse 14. Let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you were called in one body, corporate again, and be thankful. And verse 16 is what we want. Let the word of Christ dwell in you, plural, richly, in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Now he's addressing the church corporately here. And he says you need to let the word of Jesus Christ, the word that points you to Christ, dwell. Dwell where? Be at home. In you. You're internalizing it. You're owning it. And it's to be abundantly or richly, not just a little bit, in all wisdom. And then it's to overflow in, watch this, teaching and admonishing one another. So the word of God comes this way and flows that way. Teaching and admonishing one another what? In psalms and in hymns and in spiritual songs. A little variety there. With doctrinally sound music. And this is happening because you're singing with grace, and I believe it's best understood in this context, gratitude, in light of the parallel passage in Ephesians 5, with gratitude in your hearts to the Lord. So the singing is going this way because you're responding that way. You see, remember, God reveals his truth to us. We respond to him in faith and in worship. And as we do, this overflows horizontally in teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Now, what do we learn from this? Well, we learn that worship begins with the word of God impacting our hearts. than singing with gratitude to the Lord, which teaches and admonishes other believers. But again, these psalms and hymns and spiritual songs are, again, need to be doctrinally correct in light of the word of Christ dwelling in us richly. And do you know that when you're singing songs to the Lord and you're singing from your heart and these songs are true to the word of God, you are also teaching other people. And you are admonishing other people. And you are encouraging other people. And you may be comforting other people by the very songs you're singing. Furthermore, we note from this that a variety of doctrinally sound music is encouraged, as is congregational singing. This is all plural here. This isn't sitting like a bump on the log while you're here. This isn't staying in the fellowship hall until the singing's done, because now I'm coming in for the main attraction. This is being part of the service. Singing is unto the Lord out of gratitude, even if it's making a joyful noise. And the fact is, if everyone's singing, you're covered by the good voices. And that's why here at DBC, we're very particular about our music. But we also want to be very encouraging in who we're worshiping and who we're singing to and how it's overflowing. We want it to be Christ-exalting, personally edifying, doctrinally sound, with variety, and we do. Now go to 1 Timothy chapter 2. So we get another snapshot. Not one passage that tells us at all, just kind of piecing this all together here. But this is a passage that emphasizes prayer when we gather. Chapter 2, verse 1, you're familiar with it. Therefore, I exhort first of all that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and all who are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and reverence, for this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior. And so we see here the place of prayers, intercession, giving of thanks, supplications for all people, and even for our government leaders. Prayers to be an important part of our church gatherings. Now, dropping down to verse 8, he gets specific to the men. And the word men here speaks of an adult male. I desire, therefore, that the men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands. By the way, hands are not intrinsically holy. It reflects again that your heart is holy without wrath and doubting. Now, why would they ever pray with wrath and doubting? Because they're praying for their kings. And sometimes you can get really miffed with your government leaders. And we're to pray without wrath and we're to pray without doubting, trusting the Lord. So we see here a place for public prayer for a country and a variety of other needs as well. Now while we're in 1 Timothy, go to chapter 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4. This is truly a Bible study tonight, isn't it? 1 Timothy chapter 4 and find verse 13. And let's see what we read that Paul says to Pastor Timothy. Very important, related to church worship. Till I come, give attention to reading, to exhortation, and to doctrine. The word reading here speaks of the public reading of the scriptures in the church assembly. To exhortation speaks of the application and exhortation and doctrine to the teaching of the word of God. Now, what do we learn from this passage? Again, we learn that the public reading and therefore hearing of Scripture was clearly instructed. And you know, I'm glad that here at DBC we read publicly the Scriptures on Sunday morning, and we usually read the passages before we preach on them during the sermons as well. Furthermore, expository preaching was encouraged. Reading, applying, and teaching. And those are the basic elements of an expository message. And we are committed to expository preaching. That's why in 2 Timothy chapter 4, you're familiar with the verses, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and teaching. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they'll heap up for themselves teachers, and they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables. Again, Timothy is being commanded to preach the word, and in doing so to convince, to rebuke, and to exhort with all long-suffering, patience, and teaching or doctrine. Now, what do we learn from this passage? Strong preaching with sound doctrine and practical applications are to be part of the public assembly. You know, we are not to have cotton candy preaching, but on the other hand, we're not to have clinical preaching. We are to preach the Word of God in a way in which people are instructed, but also people are challenged. And you know, at times people say to me, you know, I want practical messages, but I'm tired of being convicted. Others have told me, you know, I really like the clarity of your teaching, but do you have to take such a stand? Well, apart from the stand, the clarity goes out the window. Others have said, you know, I'm sure you were preaching at me today. Did my wife call you? Others are saying, you're not practical enough. And some want you to tell them to take a left and take a right as they go down Oxford Street. Instead of learning how to walk with the Lord, be filled with the Spirit and think principally and step out by faith on the principles and promises of the Word of God. I am not your Holy Spirit. I'm here to encourage you, teach you, at times give you counsel, provide direction with the other elders for this local church, but the Holy Spirit alone can transform you. And Jesus Christ is there to be fellowshipped with. And you need to learn to lean on him. But when we gather together, again, we're seeing this strong emphasis on the preaching of the Word of God. Now go to Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10. Our last snapshot here, at least of worship on earth. In Hebrews chapter 10, you understand that the temple veil was ripped from top to bottom when Christ died. You understand that your body now is the temple of the Holy Spirit. You understand when the church gathers together, Christ is there in his midst. Therefore, in verse 19, therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus, because we're believer priests, by a new and living way, which he consecrated for us, through the veil, that is his flesh, as he died for our sins, and offered his body a sacrifice for sin, and having a high priest over the house of God, the Lord Jesus Christ, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water, which the Old Testament priests would have to do when they sacrificed. They had to wash their bodies with pure water. Again, we've been washed, as it were, with the blood of Christ. We are qualified to come boldly. Verse 23, let us hold fast the confession of our faith without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. We see here, again, we're to consider one another. We want to stir up love and good works. But how can you do that if you don't have contact with one another? And you know, one of the ways that is done is by the public assembly, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some. They had that problem in the first century. We have that problem today, too. But in contrast to that, exhorting one another. Remember exhorting? We saw that in Colossians, even in our songs, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. singing and making melody in our hearts to the Lord. And so much the more as you see the day approaching. And again, what can we learn from this passage? We can see the imperative of assembling with other believers if possible and not forsaking this. I mean, it's true that some believers don't have a local church where they can attend, where the gospel is preached, the word of God is taught. Others forsake the opportunity. And also we see through this the need of the one another's when we gather. Again, this isn't all about you. It's about worshiping God. It's about ministering to others. And in the process, guess what? You get ministered to. But you remember the churches of Revelation 2 and 3 as the Lord Jesus would walk in the midst of them, evaluating each of them individually? And he does so today as well. And you know, where two or three are gathered together in his name, so I'm in the midst. And I'm sure there are times the Lord is saying, well, where are you? Where were you? Why didn't you gather when the church gathered? Why didn't you worship? Why didn't you remember me through the Lord's Supper? Why didn't you sing praises to me? Why did you have to do it your way? Why? And each one of us will give an account one day at the judgment seat of Christ. So what can we learn from these observations? Well, we've seen a lot, haven't we? The corporate worship of God as a local church is found throughout the New Testament. This worship must be done in spirit and in truth. As far as elements of worship involved, a number of activities. We've seen the public teaching of the Word of God. We've seen fellowship. We've seen celebration of the Lord's Supper reverently. We've seen praise / singing doctrinally sound and clear songs. We've seen prayer and giving thanks. We've seen the public reading of Scripture and expository messages, even long ones. Amen. We've seen occasional mission reports. We've seen potluck meals. We've seen preaching the gospel. We've seen taking a grace offering. All those things we see in Scripture. And by the way, all those things happen here at Duluth Bible Church as well. At some point, when we gather, you see those different elements, some more, some less, in a particular individual service. By the way, keep in mind, number four, that the objectives are worship, the exaltation of God, the edification of the saints, and then evangelism as an overflow. And lastly, everything is to be done decently and in order. And you know, we want to abide by this. We want to follow this. We want to learn from this. And again, while indeed there's not one passage that sketches out for us, do this first, do this second, do this third, we do see these elements that were there. We see some things clearly mandated, like the preaching of the Word of God, the public reading of Scripture, and so forth. We see other things patterned and exemplified in which we can learn from this when it comes to being intelligent and biblical in our worship, starting with our own hearts and then following the Word of God. But go with me to Revelation chapter 4. We're not quite done yet. For we've made some observations on worship in the early church on earth. Now let's make some observations about worship in heaven. And these are two of the most amazing chapters. And they flow right off the heels of chapter 1, which shows the resurrected Christ, chapter 2 and 3, Christ speaking to the seven churches, and now Revelation chapter 4. And what we're seeing here, dear friends, is we're seeing what's going to happen after the rapture and after the judgment seat of Christ with the raptured, resurrected, rewarded church in heaven, as we'll see represented by the 24 elders. Verse 1. After these things I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven, and the first voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking to me, saying, come up here, and I will show you things which must take place after this. And immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. Now let me point out, The one who sat on the throne, as we're going to see, is none other than God the Father. Verse 3, and he who sat there was like a jasper and a sardius stone in appearance, and there was a rainbow around the throne in appearance like an emerald, and around the throne were 24 thrones. 24 thrones, and on the thrones I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white robes, and they had crowns of gold on their heads. Now, if one's been reading Revelation carefully, you will know that the white robes, the crowns, the thrones were all descriptions given to the overcomers promised in Revelation 2 and 3. And the overcomers were overcomers because they were in Christ who overcame. And so this is again a picture of the rewarded, resurrected, raptured church. Verse 5. And from the throne proceeded lightnings and thunderings and voices. Seven lamps of fires were burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God representing the Holy Spirit. And before the throne there was a sea of glass like crystal. And in the midst of the throne and around the throne were four living creatures. Interesting creatures, full of eyes in front and in back. The first living creature was like a lion, the second living creature like a calf, the third living creature had a face like a man, and the fourth living creature was like a flying eagle. The four living creatures, each having six wings, were full of eyes around and within, and they do not rest day or night, saying, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." Now, immediately when we see the wings, when we see the words that are spoken here, we're reminded of Isaiah chapter 6. This sounds like the seraphim, a particular order of angels, as recorded in Isaiah chapter 6. And what are they doing? They're worshiping God. And what are they emphasizing? His holiness. And they emphasize it three times, which may be implicit to the Trinity, but clearly emphasizing that God is holy. Lord God Almighty emphasizes his power, who was and who is and is to come, emphasizes his eternality. In other words, they're worshiping God for who he is. Verse 9. Whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who sits on the throne, who lives forever and ever. Now let me point out, whenever. They do not do this every moment. In fact, you will see if you study Revelation that these living creatures also have some other duties they do from time to time. But whenever they give glory and honor and thanks, which are acts of worship, to him who sits on the throne, God the Father, who lives forever and ever, whenever they do that, the 24 elders fall down in this, again, posture of humility before him who sits on the throne, and they worship him, proskuneo again. They give him the worth due his name, who lives forever and ever, and they cast their crowns before the throne, saying, "You." Now notice, they worship God, first person singular, directly. "You are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. Why? For you created all things, and by your will, your sovereign will, they exist and were created." And so what do we see here in this worship? We see again the 24 elders at various times casting their crowns before the Lord, giving him honor and glory. We see God is addressed directly. We see God is worshiped for who he is, creator, sovereign, all-powerful, eternal, and especially holy. We see God is worshiped for what he has done, he has created. And in this particular scene, folks, the emphasis is on the fact that God is creator. We're worshiping him for creator. And by the way, do you ever worship him because he's your creator? Do you remember that God is creator? You are created. God is sovereign. You are subject. So as to bow down and worship him for who he is and what he's done. You're going to do this in heaven. Why not do it now? But we now move to Revelation chapter 5, verse 1. And I saw on the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll, the title deed of the earth, written inside and on the back, sealed with 7 seals, verse 2. Then I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the scroll and to loose its seals?" And no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll and to look at it. So I wept much because no one was found worthy to open the scroll or to look at it. And here are the seals that on the scroll, and it's going to tie right into Revelation chapter 6. Who's going to be able to reclaim the planet for the Lord? And it's going to be the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 5, "But one of the elders said to me, 'Do not weep. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the scroll and to loose its 7 seals.'" Notice it's the Lord Jesus Christ who's the one who's worthy to do this. Verse 6, "And I looked, and behold, in the midst of the throne, and in the 4 living creatures, and in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb, as though it had been slain, having 7 horns and 7 eyes, which are the 7 spirits of God sent out into all the earth. And he came and he took the scroll out of the hand of him who sat on the throne." Isn't it interesting? In his first coming, he was the Lamb of God. In the second coming, he's referenced as the Lamb, but he's the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David. And he's going to come as a lion. And what are they going to do in heaven? We read in verse 8. "Now when he had taken the scroll, the 4 living creatures," remember them, "and the 24 elders," remember them, "fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song." Notice they sing, saying, "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals." Why? Number one, for you were slain. You're the one who died that violent sacrificial death on the cross. And number two, you've redeemed us to God by your blood. That's why you're worthy to be worshipped. And you're worthy to take the title deed. And you did this out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation. And number three, you have made us kings and priests to our God. And notice again the idea of priests as we offer spiritual sacrifices. And number four, we shall reign on the earth. So he gives us again 4 reasons why he's being worshipped here. But that's not all. "Then I looked and heard the voice of many angels around the throne, the living creatures and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000s, and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice." Now notice, loud voice. "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing." Worthy. When you worship, that's worth-ship. You're proclaiming why God is worthy. So we're seeing here group worship, a loud voice, not a bass guitar, by the way. That's why it's loud. They're worshiping Christ directly, and there's a variety of praise. "And every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth, and such are as in the sea and all that are in them, I heard say, 'Blessing and honor and glory and power be to him who sits on the throne.'" Who's that? God the Father. "And to the Lamb," who's that? Jesus Christ. And let's do this forever and ever. "Then the 4 living creatures said, 'Amen.' And the 24 elders fell down," posture of humility, "worshipped him because he is worthy who lives forever and ever." What a scene of worship. What do we see? Worship is focused on God and Jesus Christ. It's not focused on you. It's built on sound doctrine. Everything we're reading is built on doctrine, not warm fuzzies. Worship exalts Jesus Christ for who he is and what he has done, and even what he will do. We shall reign on the earth, what he's going to do. Worship is to be directly to God. Worship at times is loud. Worship focuses on God's grace and the finished work of Christ, the Lamb that was slain. And God is worthy to be worshipped. I mean, dear friends, if you haven't sensed from all these passages that worship on earth is a prelude for worship in heaven, so why not start now? Take these truths home. Let them change your thinking. Worship the Lord at home. Worship Him throughout the day. And join us on Sundays and Wednesdays with a heart prepared to worship God in spirit and in truth in a variety of ways that exalt the Lord and edify the saints. Because worship is what God is deserving of. Let's give Him the glory due His name. And let's pray. Father, thank You for this study of Your Word. What a rich study. I know I crammed a lot into tonight. But Father, I pray we would just take this home. I pray that the saints at DBC would grow in this area of worship, that I would grow, and that when we come together, we can see that we have the elements right. We can see we have the emphasis right on the preaching of the Word. But may our hearts be right, and may we be intelligent, and may we be thoughtful, and may when we gather together, we just not go through the motion or slink our way into the auditorium, not mentally prepared or ready. But instead, may we be here, first and foremost, to worship You. Not that we can't do it at home. We can. Just like we can read the Word at home and should. Just like we can pray at home and we must. But when we gather together, we can do it together as a group of believers. And we know there's something about being in a group. There's something about uniting our hearts with others in which we worship You. Where we hear Your Word, where we pray, where we give, where we fellowship, where we love one another. We know that You have designed it that way. You've not designed spiritual growth to happen in a vacuum, but in a context of relationships called the local church. And we saw over and over again, when you come together. May we not take this for granted. May we value it, appreciate it, be so grateful for it, and want to see it perpetuated even to the next generation. Father, may the worship here be authentic. May it be from our hearts. May it be true to Your Word. May, again, we not be going through the motions. May we not be playing church. May we not just show up with the arrows all pointing towards us. But may, again, we be here to worship You. May we be here to sing praises that teach and exhort and admonish one another as we sing with gratitude in our hearts to You, as we study Your Word, as we give, as we hear missionary reports, and even as we enjoy meals together at times. Father, we know the building's not the church, the people is. But we're thankful for the building we have as well and pray that You would sustain it. We thank You too, Father, even for the giving that goes on. First of all, as an act of worship. Secondly, as a means of support for the furtherance of Your Word. And Lord Jesus, without You, all of this would be meaningless. For You're the Lamb who was slain. You're the one who died for our sins. You're the one who rose from the dead. You're the one that we worship along with the Father through the power of the Spirit. We worship God in the Spirit. We rejoice in Christ Jesus. And we have no confidence in the flesh. So thank You for this time of teaching. And ask that You would direct with the remainder of the evening now. In Jesus' name. And amen.